That might, yeah, that might work.
Okay, I know this isn't ideal, but can you see us now?
I can see you, yeah.
There we go. Well, that's interesting.
All right, what do I care?
Does this work?
I mean, it works for me. If it works, like, you're the one who's got to edit this. Like, as a producer, it looks like a nightmare, but, you know, God bless, man.
Is your I think that it works as long as your camera still on?
My camera's on, yeah. Is it showing up? Is my face showing up when I talk?
Oh.
Okay, now that's inviting me to watch a stream.
God damn it. Oh, shit.
God fucking damn it. Iona's falling apart in the second half. Are you guys following any college basketball?
No. Well, no. Who's playing?
So Iona is playing UConn right now. Okay. And like, Iona's my team. Iona's never won an NCAA tournament game. Right. This is probably their best shot ever.
What seed are they?
They're the 13 seed. They won the MAC tournament. Last year, the MAC tournament winners were St. Peter's. And they went on to, I think, the Elite Eight last year. Like, it's definitely in play for them. And they are, yeah, like, they're playing a UConn team that I think is, like, the, what are they? Oh, yeah, they're the 4 seed. But they have Rick Pitino as their coach, and this is probably the last year Rick Pitino is going to be their coach. Like, Rick Pitino is probably leaving for your St. John's as soon as the season is over. Yo, Rick Pitino is like 100% a college basketball legend who has just lived by sucking the blood out of 18-year-old athletic superstars. Dude, all right, so all you need to know about this guy is he retired, like, he left Louisville in disgrace after it was found out that he was able to get, like, some 18-year-old recruits by essentially having, like, grown women prostitutes have sex with these teenage boys. And, you know, like, the standard college sports recruiting that's been acceptable in America for, like, the last 25 years or so. He just got caught, so he had to retire in disgrace, took like Damn. 2 years off, and then came to the school that I've like been following since I was like a 10-year-old boy.
Yeah, and they're like, amazing. Y'all don't know me, right? Y'all don't know anything.
Yeah,
about
yeah, yeah.
Me, right?
Dude, it's like, yo, we're just happy to have you, Mr. Rapist, sir.
I'm like, what was the other guy?
Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
Sounds like a stand-up guy, I suppose. If,
dude,
if
he
they
rules.
Could look past everything.
He absolutely, he's the man, dude. He's got a college title at Kentucky, got a college title at Louisville.
Yeah.
This is his second time taking Iona to the tournament in 3 years being the coach there.
Yeah,
and this is it, man. He's leaving. Like, he's 100%, like, he's rebuilt his legacy enough that, like, some power conference schools are like, yeah, we're desperate for a winning season. We'll take a shot on him.
Yeah, he also has a castle in Transylvania.
Yeah.
Prime real estate, man. You should actually
he gets
see
all the 5-star recruits from Eastern Europe.
Yeah.
Oh man,
I don't know. That was a Swedish accent. I don't know what that was.
You're something.
Is
else.
That really a place?
Transylvania?
Yeah.
Well, I'm sure there's a real castle somewhere in a mountain.
Okay.
That it was
yeah,
based
that,
off of for sure.
That sounds right.
Yeah. For sure, dude. Vlad the Impaler was a real guy.
Yeah, and he did some major impaling.
Hell yeah, dude. You let him know. Like, oh, you want to come fuck with me? Here's 80 of your boys on stakes out front of my place who thought they could fuck with me.
Easy. That's a Tuesday for me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, hey, I greatly appreciate your time, Mike. This is, I think it's all officially, it'll be fine now from this point moving forward.
Will it?
I'm pretty sure. Yeah, now that everything, it's not great, but it fucking works, man. So, you know, it's good enough. But yeah, this is officially the Sexy and Saucy podcast. I'm not sure if you'll be able to hear this or not, but we have an official theme song here.
That we've been copyright stricken, 4 times now? But
no, this will be the... We have about 13 copies.
Dude, it's not a real podcast if you're not hitting the intro at the top. If you're not getting DMCA'd for your intro, are you even trying?
Amen.
I don't think you can hear it, though.
Can you hear
it? I can't hear it. Am I talking over your intro? Gravy, train. Gravy with your day. Can't find your bitch, cause she on that gravy train. Bitches, gravy, gravy train. Gravy with your dang. What's you can't find your bitch, cause she on that gravy train. Bitches, gravy. Is this the official Young Gravy podcast?
No, but one time in 2019, I was like, hey, Young Gravy, what's up? Can I use Gravy Train in a podcast? And he just responded back saying, if you shout me out every time. So shout out Young Gravy.
Shout out Young Gravy.
Yeah, that's all. Apparently, that's all it took.
Yeah.
Dude, that's actually so funny. Like I don't know if you saw, like, J. Cole did that recently. Like, he was just like, yeah, I was depressed, and I went on YouTube and typed in J. Cole type beat, and then... He just made a whole song, recorded over the beat, then emailed it to the guy, and he's like, yeah, put this out, you know, on your channel, right?
That's
like,
amazing.
Just go, yeah, make whatever, hundreds of thousands of dollars on an original J. Cole song that I'm giving you for free. But it's like, I feel like that's the wave, right? Like, just find these SoundCloud rappers who are gonna blow up in, like, 5 years and just get them to agree to stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not a bad business model.
I mean, I'm gonna start doing that for all the gas shows. I'm just gonna hit up, like, you know, Young I Got Ops and see if that guy's like, yo, yeah, sure, use my shit.
Probably start with Crack's crew. I'm sure Crack Amico probably has a couple guys he raps with.
Yeah, dude. Actually, that the dude who does his beats made the theme song for Notes of a Goon, so I'm already on that.
Oh, fuck yeah. There you go.
Yeah.
That's smart.
It's actually, we found that out on an episode of Notes of a Goon because we went to another one of Chris's buddies, like, sponsored a couple episodes of the show. And we went to, like, a page on his website, and it was the same song. Like, so he had just grabbed, and, like, another guy in the friend group had also asked for that same favor to use that song.
Right on.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, you might have to spend a lot of time listening to shit music, though.
Yeah, just true. You're going to have a lot of shit music thrown at you.
Just like, sup, man? What's up? Just bad
beats. Dude.
There's going to be people that hear that has, like, a friend tell a friend, so there's going to be, like, random Gas Digital probably, like, sayings that aren't a saying, but they're going to throw it into the songs anyways because they think it's going to help.
Just garage band beats and bad lyrics.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
Let's see.
We did that for Godfrey at one point. I remember we got like 700 submissions when I was working on Godfrey show, just like for beats to play on the show. And like a lot of the guys just were like, yeah, here's like an email, like here's like a YouTube playlist of all my songs. Go listen to like all 40 of these and pick the best one. And it's like, no, you do the work.
That's a link to a playlist.
I'm not sure which one's the best. Hilarious. You tell me.
Yeah. I can't judge my own music, so you know, they're all my babies.
I'm a little too close to it right now, so if you don't mind.
Yeah.
Let's see. You first started at Cast Digital. The first time I heard about you, you were homeless on a park bench. And,
okay.
And you were an intern, not quite yet, even like on the production staff.
Okay, that's you're conflating a couple of different things there. So okay, I started working for Gas in 2017 as an intern. We were the first, me, Alex, Becky, and Luke were the first ever intern Olympics for Legion of Skanks.
Fuck yeah. Okay.
It was actually like, I remember I was working as a contractor and LOS had like, they got rid of Jew Thug. They still had Ding Dong there and they brought on this kid, Jason, who was like, dude, I'm going through the whole lore. But he was like, he was just some kid like out of Connecticut who would drive in when they were still doing shows at the Creek. And I remember Lewis saying at one point, he's like, I had asked Jason if he wanted to come produce some shows at Gas Digital and he wasn't really committed. So Lewis was already like talking on air, like, yeah, I think we're about ready to move on from Jason as the intern. And I remember like when they had first brought him on, I was working as a contractor and I was like just driving around Westchester, just going on jobs, doing stuff, being like, man, why didn't I do that? Like my Wednesday nights are free. I could just be going around city. Like I could be working with these guys. And I kind of filed that away for the next time. For the next time that happened. And so when they were talking about getting rid of Jason, I was already showing up pretty much every week just hanging out for Skanks. And like the one of the days I was like, I realized Jason wasn't there. I helped Bobby like wrap up XLR cords at the end of a show. And Omar just looks at me. He's like, yeah, is this the new intern? I was like, dude, I'm trying to be. Like, I wanna get in this life. So he's like, all right, well, show up next week. And I showed up and they were in Austin for Moon Tower. Nobody told me. And apparently Alex had showed up, on the same day. And, the following week it was me, Luke and Alex all showed up, and Lewis decided that he wasn't going to pick an intern then, that we were all going to compete in the Intern Olympics for the month of June. And, so I showed up, and then the following week, Becky was there, and she was like, look, I was here with my resume. I just didn't want to speak up. And they put her in, and it was the four of us competing. And, so I did that for, like, by Skankfest of that year, which was, like, 3 weeks into the internship. I was already coming in on my days off to sell ads, to work on the ad sales team, and I had, like, made a couple of sales. Like, I had pretty much already cemented myself like a position at Gas by Skankfest. Damn. But I remember talking to Lewis like, yeah, keep us all. Like I don't care who wins this competition. Like I just want to work with these guys for a long time. And it ended up working out. Luke moved on. He was like head of merch for a while. Becky was taking photos for the Skanks up until like I think the pandemic. And then me and Alex both got gigs working as producers. I think By the end of my internship, I was already doing hammer fisting on the network.
Okay, that's amazing.
How long ago was that?
That was 2017. It was the summer of 2017. So I was working for them for a little bit, and like we kind of shipped some things around with like responsibilities and stuff. I had jumped on to Believe You Me pretty much immediately because that was. Like I had put in, like I remember meeting Ariel Helwani at like a UFC press event at MSG, and I asked him, I'm like, dude, I'll bring you coffee. Like I don't care. I just wanna, I want to be an MMA journalist. So like I'll do whatever, just work for free. And he gave me a hard no. I reached out to Fighter and the Kid when they were looking for an intern. Pretty much every combat sports show I could think of, I tried to work for, and they. They wouldn't, nobody would take me. So when I realized I was on a network with Bisbing, I was like, yeah, that's obviously the show that I'd like to work on. So like it conflicted, they moved Skanks to Mondays and that conflicted with BYM. So I left Skanks, but I was still working on, I think, six shows on the network. And I don't know. I had a place in the East Village. It was more than I could afford to begin with. So it kind of like blew up my savings just to pay my rent there for as long as I was there. And then the guys whose place it was, who I was subletting from, they were like giving up the lease and I had no money to get a new place. So I was like, all right, I guess on April 1st, I'm homeless.
Yeah,
but I did. I was working as a producer. I was working as a producer on Real Ass Podcast at the time. I remember because I would just show up every morning for pretty much every morning, Monday, Wednesday, Friday for Real Ass Podcast. I was still working on SDR show, still working on Believe You Me. So I don't know. I had a pretty healthy schedule. It just at that point there was not a lot of money. To be made working as a producer for Gas. So I don't know. Like that's how the homeless thing started. Okay. But I was still like, I would show up to work every day.
I mean, damn, that makes sense. I became a fan around that time. It wasn't anything. It was just that was about the time I got into to LOS. And then I found Legion of Skanks a couple months, the Real Ass Podcast a few months later. And then that I thought you were just
and then you
I
hated you Lewis and then you gave it three more episodes and then you decided Lewis was the best.
Yeah. And then I loved that. He's got a fun laugh. He gets real passionate about the stuff he likes.
It's infectious. It really is.
Yeah. Yeah.
I got a bald head. What happened next? Like, you know, your lease was up and like, what's the next step?
So it was a Monday morning. It was like a Sunday night was the last day that I was on the lease for this place. And I remember like locking up and that was that. And I went to gas that night because I had to do a comedy fight club. I was producing that when they were at Lucky Jack's in the East Village, on the Lower East Side. And I went over there, did the show. It was like 1 a.m. and I was talking to one of the comics and I was like, yeah, I guess I'm just homeless now. And she's like, all right, shut up, like, you're coming and crashing on my couch. Nice. Caitlin Rupert. So I went with her back up to Harlem and crashed on her couch for a night, woke up to the news that one of my best friends had like just died of a heroin overdose. It was like it was a really rough time. It was a rough couple of months.
Were you training with Lewis before the lease issue, or did that happen? When did that start?
No, so I was training. I started training way later. So I okay. I was doing that. I was producing. I was crashing wherever I could. I was sleeping on the train some nights, sleeping in the park some nights. But for the most part, I would say like probably 4 out of 7 nights of the week, I would find somewhere to crash for a night or two. I picked up a lot of gigs with like Rover and like those just the dog walking apps. Like looking for pet sitting. So like I would get like a whole week at a time at a place just because I was watching their dog, you know?
Right.
That's smart.
Yeah, that is smart.
Yeah. Yeah, dude. I did a lot of that shit, like TaskRabbit. Like I signed up for pretty much all of the apps I could that would get me like, you know, a night or two indoors where I would not only be staying for free but getting paid to do so. And I just saved as much money as I could doing that. So we had one of the nights though, I crashed with a buddy like all the way out in Connecticut, like mad far from the studio, and I ended up waking up late, so I missed the Monday morning staff meeting. And at that point Ralph was like, yeah, I just can't with you right now, like it's just too inconsistent. So they did fire me. They fired me off of all my shows at that point, with the exception of Believe You Me, because at that point I had like, when Lewis wasn't available, I would I'd fill in for him. I was pretty much an integral part of the show at that point. Like I made myself to a point where it would be really tough to fire me, just from that one show. So I kept showing up just for that. I wasn't even getting paid for it for a little bit. Like it was just, you know, like I wasn't even in the system, but. Lewis gave me the opportunity. He's like, look, like you're already fired, so you know it is what it is, but do you want to do like a loser leaves town match at Skankfest? And I was like, yeah, dude, that sounds fun as hell. So yeah. we did like a thing, and I built like a bunch of really fun promos around that, and I ended up boxing, or it was an MMA fight, I think, at Skankfest. We had boxing gloves on, but there was takedowns. It was wild. And that I jobbed
Dylan, right?
What? No, that was Lewis.
Oh, my bad. Okay.
That was it. That was Lewis.
Which was that one then?
That was Skankfest, the last one we did in Brooklyn. I believe it's the one that Louis showed up to. 2019, yeah, so right before the pandemic.
Okay.
And we we did that. Lost to Lewis, and you know, at that point I was canonically fired, but again, still showed up for BYM the next day. So it was kind of silly, but I got like a nice little check from Skankfest, and like I said, I'd been hustling, doing whatever I could to get a couple dollars together, and by I think like September of that year, I had found a shitty windowless room in Queens for like $500 a month, I think, and they
I couldn't imagine.
Dude, it was a nightmare. I convinced them to waive like the first, last, and security. Like, I think I had like, I can give you $1,000 today. And that was pretty much like all the money I had. And they were like, yeah, sure. Like, you can come live here. And Yeah, that was that. Like, I crashed on the floor for a little bit, eventually got like a shitty like $60 mattress from Amazon. Like, it was not the best, but I was like, all right, we're gonna make this work. And yeah, I did exactly that. And then the pandemic hit, and it's like, dude, I had old Asian like landlord who was living in the same place as me. I think there was like six people and one bathroom in this like tiny little apartment. And I would go to bed every night. Like, this was during like the height of COVID scariness. I remember going to bed, like listening to these older Asian people, just like, they sounded like they were dying through the air vents.
Just coughing everywhere.
Yeah, dude. It was rough. I was like, yo, I gotta get out of here. Like, I'm just gonna wake up to six dead bodies in this apartment with me one day. So I left. My folks were like, yo, come down to South Carolina. So I did that. And that's where I pretty much rode out the pandemic, was down in Hilton Head. And nice. Yeah, it was sick. It was sick. I love it, dude. I love South Carolina. But I went down there, and look, we did. I remember Lewis hit me with this thing because I would show up for like rap every now and then, like via Zoom during the pandemic. And he was like, 30 day challenge, 30 days, 30 minutes. Just run, right? Run for 30 minutes a day for 30 days straight. And I remember being like, he like made fun of me like it wouldn't be doable, and I was like, oh yeah, I'll show you, asshole. And yeah, it was like something to do, to you know, to just to eat the time up during the pandemic, you know. It was like, all right, we're having fun out here. And I got in pretty good shape doing that, and then I came back and Lewis was training for I can't remember what we were training. Oh yeah, it was the Ellis fight, right? Like,
he was training for that forever, it felt like a couple of years.
Yeah, dude. Well, right before the pandemic, I was supposed to box Dylan, right? Like, that was going to be at the Skankfest during the pandemic. So I showed up for like one or two training sessions, and then we did during the, like, while we were trying to ramp up, I think it was him getting ready to fight Ellis. He had like gotten Ellis to agree to a fight. So we started training pretty regularly. We were going to Diego's twice a week and then down to Mickey's gym to spar down in Jersey, Mickey Gall's place, like once a week.
Oh, really? Wow.
Dude.
I didn't know
that was so
down there.
Yo, like, legitimately. There's this one dude, Vilsin Negrani. He's like, he's from like Albania. He's a 135 pounder.
Yeah.
That dude beat my ass worse than anyone. Like, he had like a real professional fight coming up in like 2 weeks. And I'm training for like a boxing match on a raft against an old man. Yeah, he was just like, he was just looking to get some work in.
Yeah.
I remember him being like, he's like, it's fine. I know hit face. And he just beat me up to the body, to the point where I wanted to puke. I wanted to die. I was just like, that's the closest I've come to getting put out via body shot. You know what I mean? Just digging for big shots to the liver. That was super fun. That whole little run was super fun. Gotten the best shape probably in my adult life. And then he set me up with a fight at Ellis Mania in Lake Havasu. Went out there, kicked some ass. That was fun. And then, we've been working on doing it at Skankfest from here on out.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I was a little wrong about my fandom timeline. It was after the Louis Skankfest. That's when Joe Rogan talked about it. And then I was like, all right, I guess I'll get to listen to these guys. And that's when it all kind of happened.
That was it? Rogan is what got you in?
Yeah. I was a big your mom's house and Rogan fan at the time, and just worked an office gig. And, you know, I was doing my office work during the day, and I was listening to bullshit during the day as well. And just the right shadows
office,
is all
too. Office by day, Joe Rogan by night, all day.
All night.
Yeah, shout out to Diaz. Shout out to the Diaz brothers. Yeah.
Oh, awesome. Man.
Yeah. How's Mickey Gall? Did you get
Mickey's
the
man, dude?
Yeah,
Mickey rules so hard.
Yeah, I miss Yo MMA.
Do you?
Yeah. That was a good show. I listened to every single episode of it.
But that's one of those things where it's like, again, like, I don't know. It's frustrating for me because I know realistically that show just That show died because Lewis did not want to watch like an Erin Blanchfield versus Jessica Andrade main event. You know what I mean?
Come on. She's a tank. She's knocking bitches out all day long, all night.
Until she fights Erin Blanchfield and gets choked the fuck out. But like, that's my thing is like, I'm an actual, like, I'm a loser who loves MMA. Yeah. Like, Lewis is like, oh, this is something I can broadcast passionately on, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that's off of Dave's fans,
Where it's like, yeah, like, all right, now watching the UFC becomes homework. And it does kind of suck, like, that aspect of it, like, where, you know, anytime I would like to do anything different on a Saturday night, like, when I was booking a comedy club and, like, working a comedy club every single Saturday night, I would still have to be sitting, like, essentially in gorilla position, like, just on my phone watching the fights because that's my job, you know?
Right. Yeah.
Right. So like, did you have to do that for like Michael Bisping or?
Yeah. For Bisping show. Like I can't, you will never see a Monday morning where I'm showing up to Bisping show and I haven't watched at the very least the entire main card for that Saturday night, if not every fight from the prelims on.
And you just give him a rundown of like the story of the fight, tale of the tape type deal.
Yeah, so like my notes for Monday mornings are like whatever the five or six biggest news stories of the weekend are, like obviously when Chris Rock slap happened, like shit like that has to go on there. And then like a full results recap from the event, any of the performance of the night, fight of the night, like any of the performance bonuses, and then also run through the the big storylines coming out of it, right? So like Dana's reaction after, who called out who on the mic, and then the second half of the show typically is like just whatever the other big news in MMA is, what Connor's doing, what Jake Paul's doing.
Of course, gotta get it in. That's usually pretty the first part of any show, any MMA show, but good on y'all to actually talk about the fights, you know.
You have to. So I think that's why, if I had to guess, like that's why Yo MMA is no longer a thing. It's got nothing to do. Like people were watching. It was fun. It was like you said, like I people do miss it for a reason because it is very fun. And I do love Lewis. Like, I don't know, like that dude breaks down MMA in a way that like, okay, that actually does make sense, both from like a promoter standpoint and like, you know, like a fan standpoint, you know?
Yeah, and he just—it's one of the few things that make him just yell.
Yeah.
It's nice to see him. It's nice to see him get a little just sprung up. That's all. And just pop off a little bit.
Dude, I was watching that. I was watching that clip the other day from when Rogan was in studio with the gun in the butt. And it is—it's wild, dude. Like Chris from Brooklyn still makes fun of everybody because in the morning. Rogan came in, like Artie Lang came in and did an episode with Rogan at the Gas Studios. Like it was like an away game episode for Rogan from our place, which was pretty tight.
Yeah.
And then Rogan stuck around and did Legion of Skanks with the boys. And I remember like everybody waited until after Legion of Skanks. And then it was just like a line of people waiting to get pictures with him. And instead, Chris from Brooklyn just sat inside and like filmed all of us in a line waiting to meet Rogan. He's like, look at these fucking nerds. These absolute homos.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
I love it.
One of my questions was, what does a producer do? Because, you know, you guys are behind the camera, and I don't know if y'all just sit there and just film, make sure the film's still on, or, you know, is there something that I'm missing about being a producer? How hard is the job? It sounds like you got to do a lot of homework and watch a bunch of prelim garbage fights.
Well, no such thing as a garbage fight in the UFC, baby. Best in the world. Don't know them yet.
The 6:30 p.m. prelim cards.
So Joey Diaz used to talk about that all the time back in the day. He's like, these idiots are spending all this time breaking down the main event because that's where the most money is. That's where the most views are, right? But he's like, the real gambler, right? The real guy who's making money betting on this sport put, you know, 10 dimes on some guy in the fourth fight of the night because it's like that's where the actual value is.
Yeah, but how much would you really know about these? Well, I guess, yeah, that's where you do your homework.
Like, I remember when Darren Till debuted fighting on, like, Rotterdam cards, you know, like the European ones where the prelims would start at, like, 2:30 in the morning and the main card starts at, like, 6 a.m. You know, and, like, I remember staying up late for those fights when Darren Till was the third fighter on the card and he was only, like, a minus 210 favorite. And it's like, oh, yeah, this is an absolute no-doubter, no-brainer. Like, put your entire bankroll on this guy because you'll never get a price like this again.
Some people,
the job as a producer is to... Yes, it's to like it's to do the notes and make sure that you have like a show outline heading into it, but also to bring up multimedia elements, right? Like the obviously YouTube has changed the game for what podcasting is and what it can be. So to have these people having this conversation and then pull up the visual cues for whatever they might be talking about, or you know, something funny and silly that fits in with what they're talking about, you know. Like, I remember, I had a direction from Lewis. Like, at one point, the phrase slippery slope came up, and he just had me pull up, like, from a Japanese game show, like, a man doing, like, a body slide down, like, a line of women with oil on them. And it's like, all right, you got to hit that anytime he says the word slippery slope.
Yeah, and that's a whole Saturday night. If you want to just go watch Japanese game show antics, that's several hours of just nonstop laughter, because it's the most ridiculous stuff I've ever seen on any platform.
So I remember funny. Danny Polischuk was on HSR a couple weeks ago, and he was saying that he's like, yeah, find me the guy who got blasted out of a recliner 40 feet into the air into a body of water. And it's like, all right, well, it's 10 minutes of on-air time of me focusing on nothing but finding clips from MXC from 20 years ago. But yeah, that's really the job is to, like, I want to, the goal of the producer is to make it as visually stimulating as possible to just keep eyes on the program.
Right.
That's fair.
Like, the way I put it is, like, I work with the funniest people on the planet. I need to be able to convey their funny to people who aren't familiar with them. Right. If it's your first time ever checking in on an episode of High Society Radio, I wanted to look and sound as good as possible, to have as many multimedia elements so that by the end of it, you're like, damn, I cannot miss an episode of these guys anymore.
Yeah. Yeah. That. OK. But see, those are his kind of questions. Mine are like, did Lewis actually pay you $5 for installing his bidet, or did he pay you the full 20?
I mean, he paid me. Way more than that. I think he, I think, like, by the, so, like, and this is, like, credit to Lewis, like, when I didn't have as much going on as I do now, like, the guy would just hit me with, like, little odds and end jobs, you know? Like, there was, when I was homeless, like, I got a whole weekend of staying at Lewis's house, and all I had to do was, like, build a TV stand, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's a real friend, you know?
Yeah,
awesome. Yeah, that's how I kind of fell or got to know your character, at least.
I think I still have a running tab where Lewis owes me like $500 or something like that. But here's the thing: it takes you a long time to get paid. But his rates are significantly better than you think they would be.
Okay, all right, that's fair. Right on. Yeah. Hell yeah.
So. Luis J. Gomez, how good is he? Like,
he doesn't watch anything. I'm the like, LOS, and
He showed me.
I occasionally watch Believe You Me.
He showed me videos of him, like putting hands to you, just like easily.
Oh well, the one where you throw up and you're like, I threw up blood, and then I think Luis is like, there wasn't blood in there.
Well, no. All right. So he hit me on the nose, which then caused blood, and then the vomit.
Oh, yeah.
So there was blood in the puke. So I think that counts.
Yeah. So he's good enough for blood and vomit.
I was not doubting it.
So I would say I've sparred Lewis probably at this point 100 rounds. Jeez, I think I've taken one off of him. Like, and I can distinctly remember it. It's when I was in the best shape of my life, right before the John Matthews fight. We were both exhausted. We'd done like nine rounds, maybe. Like, I think we did like two against each other earlier in the day, like, because we just rotate, right? So at Mickey's gym, you spar for 5 minutes, you get 90 seconds off, pick a new, like, get a drink of water, pick a new partner in that 90 seconds, and then keep it moving, right? Like, find somebody else, another hard 5 minutes. And yeah, I did. So it was like me and Lewis at first, in like the first round. He won, moved around, went to like a bunch of different people. And then like the end of the night, like it was literally just me and him were like the last two guys still going. And I'm like, all right, I'll give you one more. And I remember he kept spamming this overhand right. And I just got the timing of it perfect where I was able to duck underneath and then like pop up with a 1-2 and like catch him off of that. And then just use speed to like move around the entire gym because there was nobody else sparring. And I'd say that's the one time I've ever taken a round off of him, and that was still close. Nice. Lewis is – don't fight Lewis. He'll fuck you up.
He's called the Puerto Rican rattlesnake for a reason.
Oh, yeah.
Marcus. God damn. Like, he doesn't know
people
anything.
People clown on that? People are like, oh, yeah, you know, like whatever. It's like, all right, try him. See what happens. He'll fuck you up. Yeah,
he's so much bigger in person than I expected, to be honest. Because like, I saw him at Skankfest South, and that's when I ran into him. Beast of a man. I was lucky enough to go to Vegas last year. Same thing.
Hell yeah.
Beast of a man. Which this is a good time to say, I'm the guy who gave you candy the entire weekend.
That was you?
That was me.
Oh, dude, you rule. Thank you so much. I appreciate that.
That's all he wanted. Podcast over. Interview over. That's all he wanted.
Dude, that rules. Fucking, because I was, we were on a very strict, it was like my first time since my first one. My first Skankfest, I was totally sober, but every other one, I've done all the acid and mushrooms and whatever else I can get my hands on.
I'm sure
on.
They hand you and, everything.
Yeah, Alex and I both abstained this year because she was having the baby. And it was one of those things where I was like, dude, if I do acid and I'm having a full-on acid trip while Alex has to stay sober, I will be – it'll, like, ruin the trip for me. I'll just be depressed, you know? Mm-hmm. But I remember I can't remember what it was, but you gave me Alex's favorite candy. And I remember, like, holding on to it until we got back to the hotel room that night. And it was, like, in my pocket. I was like, oh, yeah, by the way, I got this for you. And she – couldn't have been happier. So I really do appreciate that.
That's amazing. It was a white chocolate Reese's little peanut butter thing.
That was my thing.
Oh, that
but
was
you
your
kept
thing?
Handing me candy every time I saw you.
Was it? So was it a fruit roll up?
It was a fruit roll up. Yes.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah, dude. And it was like, how the hell are we going to get our, how the hell are we going to get a fruit roll up?
Yeah. Well, I'm just fat. I like candy. Turns out sour candy while standing around and, you know, I'll get parched in the mouth, throw in some sour candy. It'll help, you know, saliva get in my mouth.
Ready to go. I respect it, dude. Yeah. Some warheads. That always gets saliva going.
Yeah. Yeah. And we do a podcast and he's snacking for the whole, the whole time. Every time
that's
I look
get
up,
annoying
it's
as hell.
Just some kind of weird, obscure candy that he has.
Some nuts here.
What are those? Are these the corn flavored?
No, I threw those away. Damn it.
Yeah, he literally bought like corn flavored almonds. I'm like, who would buy corn flavored?
Wait, so it's like corn on the outside of an almond?
I'm sure it's some Midwestern thing. It's elote, a Mexican style street corn.
Oh yeah, elote rules. Elote is delicious.
Yeah, but it tastes like corn on a nut. You don't want corn. You're eating nut, expecting nut flavor, and it's corn.
I don't know. Whenever I eat nut, it typically tastes like a guy.
I'm sure you. Oh gosh, yeah. Smokehouse flavor, I'd recommend. Shout out to the smokehouse flavor. But elote can eat dick. Fuck you, elote. Corn, shitty corn.
Feel elote from like when it, 'cause it's got like that like fucked up cheese that's like it's you're like, should this really be out here on a warm cart? Like this doesn't seem right, but it's actually fucking banging. I don't know how they do it without killing people in Mexico, but man, that is a fun little street treat.
Yeah. Built different. Yeah, hilarious.
I'm actively watching Iona just blow this. This sucks, dude. They're down fucking 20 in like the final minutes. They were up by 2 at the half and just blew it in the second half. Nightmare shit.
Yeah, we're off in Dayton land, so Ohio. I feel like I have to pay attention to Dayton. They're actually pretty good, pretty decent.
Yeah, dude, the Flyers are always good for an upset or two in the tournament.
Yeah, yeah. So
I saw Dave Portnoy was in town because someone posted a selfie with him.
In Ohio?
Yep.
What's he doing out there?
I have no idea.
Dude, Barstool, OVC?
I'm sure he probably bet on the game probably and just went, got a first row seat, something like that. I don't know.
Damn, that rules. I wanted to do that for a while because I lived in Westchester and like I had... Like I was doing good at one point. Like I was like I was doing all right as like a contractor. And I remember thinking like, dude, it would be so sick to get tickets to their G League affiliate of the Knicks. You know what I mean? Like the minor league basketball team, and just pull up to like the Spike Lee seats for them. You know what I mean? Just like show up every single game like in like a full 1970s pimp suit, like just really own it. Like, yeah, dude, this is it. I run half court.
You would definitely need a feather in your hat.
Yeah, dude, for sure. Actually, we just watched Live and Let Die last night, the Bond movie from the 70s where the villain is like a guy who sells heroin in Harlem. Like essentially the villain is like Frank Lucas from fucking American Gangster.
Yeah.
And that shit is like, damn, like that's when they figured it out. Like when pimps in the 70s, those guys knew what they were doing, man.
It all figured out, right?
Yeah. Dude, I want to go back to that, man, where you could just walk down the street in like a fucking mink coat with feathers in your hat and a fucking... cartoonishly long cane.
Yeah, bitch, yeah. Where's my cane?
Hey, seeing fat asses all over the place isn't too bad either.
Yeah, it's all right, but like I don't know, there's something very like, there's something awesome about just like a classy broad in like a full dress, you know what I mean?
That's true. Yeah, that's true.
Yeah,
well, yeah.
Was it more satisfying to beat up Dylan or Paco?
I never fought Paco.
Well, who'd you fight at Skankfest Vegas then?
I'm trying to process. So I think I sparred 2 rounds with Paco before Skankfest Vegas. I fought Boogerbeard at okay. Who's like a guy, he's like big on MMA Twitter.
Damn it. Well, there's the pot then for you. Jesus Christ, can't remember shit. What? Sorry.
No, I mean you guys need a producer to give you better notes.
Ringo, what the fuck?
I'm guessing that's your dog or cat.
It's what we call our fake producer. Whenever something goes, he's very real. Sorry, he's definitely on the payroll. Okay. And
we did, that came up out of nowhere. Because I think Boogerbeard was talking shit to Lewis and I on Twitter, and I just responded like, yo, I hope he takes this fight because I want to watch you get knocked out in person. And he's like, oh, yeah, you want to watch me get knocked out? Why don't you do it then, bitch? And I'm like, all right, I think I'm afraid of you, motherfucker.
He talked a lot of game for how he fought.
He talked so much shit, dude. He was, I mean, the guy was 6'2" at the time, probably outweighed me by about 30 or 40 pounds. And, yeah, I'm really proud of that one. Like that was one where I went into it like, I don't know. Like the John Matthews fight was super fun for me because we both kind of started. He started out ahead of me, but I knew like I had enough physical advantages that it was going to be like, all right, whoever works harder leading up to this fight is going to win. And I'm real proud of that one. But I don't know, dude. Boogerbeard just talked so much shit, and he was so much bigger than me that like. For me to go in there, and I don't think I got hit once. Like I legitimately think it was a full on shutout on the CompuBox sats. I don't think he landed anything that wasn't on my gloves.
Wow.
Yeah, so to have him being like, I'm gonna fucking make your baby an orphan, to knocking him down and getting to the point where Ellis had to be like, all right, I can't watch this guy get his ass kicked anymore. It was a pretty special feeling.
Right.
That being said,
well,
I feel like if everybody got to hit Dylan in the face a couple of times, they'd be like, all right, he's not that bad of a guy.
That's fair.
Like, there is something about that, like, just smarmy prick attitude where it's like, once you've hit him just a couple of times and wiped that smirk off his face with your fist, you're like, all right, he's a decent kid. He's trying.
Yeah.
Okay. Dylan, he happened to have accidentally, I was just in a little group and he got a big dummy. It was like a gorilla or like Godzilla kind of finger looking joint. And I think it might have been from one of those like fake weed stores on Fremont Street or something.
Okay.
But he just gave it to the group that I was hanging out in. So he's not too bad in my eyes either.
He took a couple of drags and he's like, all right, get this Delta 8 away from me. You guys figure it out.
Yeah, something. I don't know.
All right. Well, I got to get – Alex needs her computer back. She has to schedule a Legion of Skanks for tonight. So
oh, right okay. on.
Do you well, guys right have on. Anything else?
No, I was just going to ask about Michael Bisping. What is he like, you know, behind the cameras?
So Bisping is, I'll say this, Bisping has given me the best bonus I've ever received from any person I've ever worked for anywhere. Like, Bisping is, he's super generous. He's super gracious. I mean, this is a guy who has, I mean, he's got, 2 million Instagram followers. He's got fucking multiple world titles at home. And yet he arranges his day around my schedule way more than should be possible. You know what I mean? Like, it's like he's a super cool person to work for. It's a little cringe thinking about it now, but like before I met him, for like a year and a half, I had the shot of I think it's Big John McCarthy. He's like just fucking yoking up Bisping and dragging him off of Luke Rockhold's unconscious body as Bisbing's like, ah, yeah. You can see like the fucking, the Union Jack on his mouthpiece. Like, from the moment where he won the title, that was the background of my phone for like a year and a half, 2 years, like up until I started working for Legion of Skanks. So to go from, that to now like talking to the guy, like being able to text him while he's broadcasting a UFC event is just crazy to me. Bisping rules. Bisping is such a fun person to work for. So knowledgeable. He's put me up at his house. Like they flew Brian and I out there at one point to record a couple episodes at his house. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know, dude. Like it's working for him has been an absolute dream. I don't know. I can't say enough nice things about the guy. And, yeah, I don't know. In my opinion, we make the best, MMA podcast on the planet. So getting that opportunity from somebody who was willing to work for free for anyone who would give him a shot in this business to, producing something that I think is the industry leader right now is it's incredible to me. It's so dope. And, I do owe that all to Bisping. And, you know, obviously a large part to Lewis for bringing me on to work with them in the first place and being like, all right, square peg, square hole, let's get it done. But yeah.
What are the future plans for Mike Harrington? Do you have any future fights coming up or do you want to fight someone? And
yeah, I got to take a fight at Skankfest. I'm as fat as I've ever been. I just went with Alex to the midwife today and I got on the scale fully clothed. With like three sets of keys in my pocket, but I was tipping 265.
Oof.
Like it's a problem.
Yeah, that's bad.
My lightest, I got down to like 179.5. So to have put on 90 pounds it's extreme. And
a lot of something.
Pretty much the only thing that'll get me even remotely in shape is taking a fight. Like I tell that to people all the time. It's like, you want to get in the best shape you've ever been in, take a fight, book an amateur fight. Because you're just not going to want to, you're not going to be willing to be embarrassed on that day, right? Like any kind of work you're putting in, any kind of training or running or cardio, whatever, it pales in comparison to the embarrassment of losing a fight. Mm. So, you know, I book something.
Is it going to be Paco next? Or do you know who you want to fight?
Probably not anybody who works at Gas Digital. Just because, like, doing that with Dylan was super weird. Like, it was super weird knowing for a year I was going to fight this guy, and then tensions ramping up. And then I saw again with Dylan and Paco. Like, Dylan and Paco fought at this last Skankfest, and I'm pretty sure they're still blocking each other on, like, all social media. Like, they don't fuck with each other. And that's, like, it is, like, a weird thing comes about when you when you're fighting someone who you're working that closely to. So, ideally not somebody at Gas. I mean, I would maybe Cody Mero from Anakin Florian podcast. I put out the challenge to Chappelle Lacey from Fighter and the Kid. That dude's like he's a big boy, and he was like he was a college cheerleader, he can move, but still,
he's an athlete. Got some feet.
That's a big boy, dude. So, you know, like that'd be a challenge. That'd be something I'd have to work really hard towards. I don't know. Pretty much any comic who's booked on Skankfest, I'll fight at Skankfest.
I mean, that's a wide list. That's a broad net.
I've been trying to fight Lev Fur for like 3 years.
Oh, Lev should do it. Did. He's super fat.
He's so fat. And I feel like it would get him in shape. Okay. But he won't do it, dude. He just refuses. He's kind of pissed made. So,
Lev, you're a pussy.
Dude, everyone who's listening to this show, tweet at Lev Fur telling him to fight me at Skankfest in Vegas this year.
Perfect. Perfect. Clip it.
Yeah, do you, Ringo.
Do you have any other future projects coming up, or do you just plan on just staying the course of just producing the shows you produce?
Producing the shows I produce for sure. Spit Roast is blowing up right now. So that's super fun. I'm really getting a big kick out of working on that. I love producing a live show at the Stand every other week. And then to boot, I also have I'm booking a comedy club in the East Village, 7th Street Comedy Club. Shout out, love working for those guys. Great little BYOB spot. But yeah, I think the only other big thing I'm working on outside of the main Gas shows is I've been doing these watch-alongs with I've been doing it with Brian from Believe You Me, and then we've been having various comics stop by. It's like a cool concept, right? If you're in the East Village, you have spots at the Stand or New York Comedy Club or whatever, and you have like an hour or two to kill, instead of just sitting around a comedy club getting drunk, come to Gas Digital, get drunk, watch some fights, stream it out to some people. So we've been having some success with that. Guys have been showing up. And it's been like Lewis calls it the bite companion because we're biting off Joe Rogan. But I don't know, dude. Fucking everybody's doing. Live streaming is the future, man. Like, it really live streaming, yeah. Being able to connect to an audience in real time, I think that's how people really start fucking with you. Because it's like, all right, this is just going to be something that's on in the background for the next 6 hours of fights. Like, I could listen to the broadcast team, or I could listen to these assholes. And for some reason, hundreds and thousands of people on a weekly basis are choosing to listen to us assholes. So that's been pretty cool. GasDigitalNetwork.com/live or on the Gas Digital YouTube page for the prelims for pretty much any UFC card. And then I think we're going to try to get Zach in for WrestleMania, which would be sick.
Awesome. Nice. Awesome. All right. Well,
all right. One last question.
Go ahead.
Leon Edwards or Usman?
Leon Edwards, baby. It's Rocky's right time. Right, Kamaru on. Usman, 36 years old. He's got busted knees. His back's blown out. He was talking for a solid like year and a half about how he was going to have to move up to light heavyweight because there's no more challenges at welterweight, and openly talking about his retirement from the sport. Dana White says it all the time. If you're talking about retirement, you're already 1 foot out the door. You're not 100% committed to being a killer in the octagon. Mm-hmm. You shouldn't be taking fights. And that's where Kamaru Usman's at. He's 36 years old, coming off his first knockout. Rocky Edwards, 31, I believe. The first time they fought, Rocky was in his very early 20s and Usman was very close to his prime. Second time they fought, Leon in his prime, Kamaru in the back end of his prime. We saw how that happened. Now you're about a year later, coming off of Usman's first knockout. Leon has to feel as confident as he ever has, fighting on his home turf in his backyard. Oh, and by the way, it's at sea level, so I don't have to worry about Leon flagging like he did in the second, third, and fourth rounds of that second fight, fighting at a mile high elevation in Salt Lake City, where Usman was used to that. Usman was training his entire training camp in Denver, getting ready for the elevation. Like, this is a much more even playing field. I think Leon Edwards gets it done. I could see a decision, but I think he's going to finish him probably inside the first three.
Oh, there we fantastic. Go. Fantastic. Great soundbite.
We'll see
great,
how yeah. we'll see how close you are.
Dude, Rocky inside of three rounds, that's got to be like plus 500, plus yeah. 600. So make some money, boys.
All right. All right, I got 20 right bucks. Well, right. Mike, thank you so much for your time, man. You are a legend. You are the champ. My memory is shit, but God damn it. It was fun having you on, man.
Appreciate yeah. it. Dude, thanks awesome. For having me. Absolute pleasure.
See you guys.
Peace.
Peace. Man, what a fucking podcast.
Yeah. That was all right. Awesome. Like, he really just can talk. I didn't expect him to...
Yeah, I wasn't expecting him to have chops to be able to do that, but damn, good questions, man.
Yeah. This was, man. He knows. He's like a professional speaker. He's like a professional, like.
It's like he talks for a living or something.
Yeah. But like the bit about Usman and Leon, like that was a tight, you know, concise. He's been thinking about.
Well, that's his job, apparently.
Yeah. But yeah, that's awesome. Yeah.
Amazing. And yeah see, I did give people candy at Skankfest.
Yeah,
first of all, I did give people sugar, and I'm glad he appreciated that much. I'm glad he really lit up about that.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah. I'm glad we had like two ways to ask him questions, or two directions from which to ask some questions.
Yeah, definitely. Because you know, yours were more professional.
Oh, well, they were just about fighting, you know. He has that's the fair. Fighting part, and he has the skank fest part. And
Skank, I'm the asshole.
Sure.
Skank.
What? Make wrestling seem gay.
What?
It's just guys in tights flipping each other around. It's not gay. Still real to me, goddamn.
They want everything in their mouth, not just beer.
Clip it.
Okay. Well, you want to keep going? Awesome. Are you tired of being at my house? Because we should have recorded before he came on the podcast, maybe. Maybe we would have been warmed up or something. But we just like watched clips about wrestling together.
Awesome.
And hung out.
It's all fun.
It was great. Fun. It was amazing time.
I wish we would have like had everything kind of set up. That should have been what we did. I was just kind of unfamiliar with how we were gonna connect with them. You know, Zoom. What was the other?
Honestly, that was stressing me out too. If I'm gonna be completely honest.
Yeah.
Part of me is like, I still have to edit the Bricks podcast.
I'm glad there's
a whole lot of editing.
Yeah, so many platforms.
Oh, I meant that. Ringo. Do your fucking job, man. We need content out there. What the fuck's your problem?
Yeah, that Discord thing worked out. That's awesome. Because it was Zoom, didn't work, and then the other thing didn't work. And then...
Yeah, I'm glad I thought of my feet, and I was like, oh, yeah, I can still share my screen, though.
Yeah.
So, you know, fuck yeah. It's funny that Mike Harrington, of all people, were like, well, you tell me if it's good. You're the one that has to edit it. that was... All right. What a legendary podcast. Shout out to Mike Harrington. Shout out to Gas Digital. Shout out to all those folks.
Yeah, that worked out. I didn't expect it to go that well.
You're not even talking into the mic.
This guy, this thing.
You're not even talking into it.
You're supposed to be preparing me for the best show I can make. I'm the Michael Bisping, and you're...
Oh, well, apparently editing this might be... If I just now noticed that.
Oh, no. You're good. It was up.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
But well, no, this was way better than I thought it would be. He's really like polished as far as like talking. I was impressed.
I think
we got
a
long way to go.
I had like an outer body moment where I was like, does he just think he's doing like a nice favor for a couple of guys that have no idea what they're doing? Because like we spent easily. It felt like 20 minutes at the top just trying to be like, can you hear me now? Can you see me? And then he was like, you have to edit it. I don't care.
Yeah. But I'm glad you picked up what we were putting down. That was awesome. I felt more comfortable when he like knew a bunch of MMA stuff. So if anything got hairy, I could just ask him a bunch of MMA questions.
Okay, yep.
But the Legion of Skank stuff, that's just not my ballpark.
That's my territory.
But Krakamiko, I'm so ready right now to meet him.
Staple Dallas to my tits, bitch, I'm cracking me, go. Ooh. Rattlesnake, Louis J, reppin' Puerto Rico. We got hella bad bitches, and they like to deep throw. But I still suck a dick, bitch, I'm cracking me, go. Crack. Miko.
Ooh. Yeah, man.
Shout out to Crack Miko. He's coming on. Yeah, we have a podcast with him coming up. Which we can say because we're recording this now.
What?
What? Anything else that you want to talk about? Do you want to keep pushing forward? We could, Ringo, edit this out if we keep moving forward. But you want to keep moving forward?
No.
Okay.
Fuck, man, well, I can't keep a straight face. Oh, but yeah, man. I am beyond impressed by Mike. He was.
You need to go. Really, you need to go and get on Twitter, and you need to go on your Twitter and follow him at least.
Yeah, he really lifted this episode. You know, I try to.
Oh yeah. Well, I mean, I was curious how his start. I legitimately thought he was just homeless and lived near the studio. Right. And they were just like, well, he's homeless outside. We could just give him a couple bucks, and he'll go do stuff for us for the day. At least he won't be in front of the studio today.
Yeah.
To a certain degree, that's literally what I thought he was. But I'm just an idiot. I haven't been the biggest fan forever. So
no, that worked out, man. He was very like patient, gracious. He gave great stories. I had that urge because you know. A lot of times, a bunch of interviewers, they want to hear themselves talk instead of hearing the person that they interview talk. And I was like, why would you ever, like, you're interviewing a guy. Like, let him talk. But I felt that. Like, I felt like I wanted to say way more than I just touch on things that he would say. And I had to fight that urge to interrupt him and just let him talk. I'm glad I did. I'm glad you did, too. Like, you didn't interrupt too much. But
and I am bad at it, really bad at it. I didn't realize how bad it was until I'm editing this Bricks podcast, and I'm like, I am an asshole. I don't like I Rick Brick said one thing, and then I was like, here's three more things.
I'm gonna let you speak, but Beyonce had one of the greatest albums of all time.
What?
that was awesome. I hope we can do more and. Hopefully we can get a producer to actually, like.
I hope we end up getting a producer one day.
I did a little bit, you know.
Yeah, with your alarm going off.
I came in with my heart.
Your scheduled sounds. Thanks for the soundboard, buddy.
At least I came in with the hard-hitting questions of, what does a producer do? I thought they just look at the camera.
I thought he was legit going to be like, well, I told you. I helped get it set up, but I had to bring cables around, ran an errand.
Yeah. But no, it was a whole different.
He was like, you think I don't have a fucking job? I'll show you.
I'm going to watch this prelim, fight.
I watch MMA like it's my job, bitch.
Because it is.
This ain't a game. You think it's a game?
You think Michael Bisping watches anything?
What?
Nah, but that's awesome. I didn't know. That's awesome. That's really
I really enjoyed that. Okay. Well, done, do you hear that off in the distance?
Oh, yeah. Do you have your mashed potatoes ready? Love, bitch. Love is good. Love can be strong. But I'm a cold food. I got mashed potatoes. But I got no gravy, baby. Oh, here it comes. Ooh. I hear you. Jason, rich on the beat, bitch. Gravy, train. Gravy with your name. You can't find your bitch, cause she on that gravy train. Bitches, gravy, train. Gravy with your name. Can't find your bitch, cause she on that gravy train. Bitches gravy, train. Gravy, train. Gravy, train. Gravy with your name. Bitches gravy. Shout out to Young Gravy. This has been the Sexy and Saucy Podcast featuring Mike Harrington. Nice.